Hey everybody, thanks so much for coming to Hall H. This is the first time we're doing this one-man show with Joss in Hall H, so it's incredible to see the size of this room. I hope you haven't all been here since last night. I hope you get a chance to come by the Dark Horse booth at 2615 down on the main floor. We've got most of the comics work that Joss has ever done, from Frey to Buffy the Vampire Slayer, Angel and Faith. Those two books are now in their season 10. Heading toward the climax of the 10th season. Angel and Faith ends with issue 25, and Buffy season 10 ends with issue 30 next year. Dark Horse is headed into our 30th anniversary in 2016, and it's been an incredible time, and we've had an incredible history with Joss. In the last year, we've told you that we want to bring more Serenity comics out, and the editor on the Serenity comics, Jim Gibbons, has approved the outline for the next series, so we've got a sequel to Leaves on the Wind coming, probably coming next year, and I'm happy to say that George's Genty is coming back. And we're going to have more announcements about that book to come soon, including the release date. But right now, give us a huge Comic-Con welcome to the creator of Serenity and Angel and Faith and Frey and Buffy the Vampire Slayer and the director of The Avengers and The Avengers 2, Joss Whedon.
I want to say terrifying, but I'm going to walk around a little bit because I want to see you guys better. You guys are pretty foxy. This is good. Thank you. I love you guys. I think you know that I love being here. I had to miss it last year, but as you can see, I'm a whole person now. It's been an interesting time. There's been a lot going on. I don't know if any of you saw, but I made another movie. And those are hard. Those are super tiring. And we may talk about that a little bit if you have questions about it. But what I want to talk about for just a minute is how ridiculously grateful I am to everybody at Dark Horse for doing what is honestly one of the hardest jobs in the world. When you take a licensed product, when you take something that already exists, and you have to continue those stories, you have to be so faithful and yet so inventive to make the stories come to life. And that is a tightrope act. It is really difficult for someone, for anyone, to carry on something that is already beloved, take it to another level, while still being true to all the voices and the characters and what we were trying to do way back when. And I'm, you know, to Scott, and you know, who's been my editor forever, and Sierra, who was working on the books, Mike Richardson, who built the house we're all in, and particularly, you know, the writers and artists. Christos Gage has been killing it. Rebecca Isaacs and George's, of course. Zach Whedon, a little awesome. And, you know, it's just, I feel like like 5 years ago, a tornado ripped up my house and dropped it in the land of Marvel. And it's been a very weird, time. And it was like weird, and you were in it, and you were there, and you were there, and it was, all that while, all of these people have been working so hard and doing such beautiful work, and it's been so great for me to know that the things I care most about are being taken care of. So I just want to give these guys a huge shout out. Please, a round of applause for Dark Horse. They're amazing. Some other stuff has happened, which I'll get to. I I got very old since I was here last. Old and infirm and blithely incontinent. And so I feel like, I don't know, I should have some wisdom. I should have gotten some of that. I'm, you know. And that didn't work out, didn't go my way. But I was hoping to impart some, but unfortunately we don't have any. What I do have now, now that there is no place like home and I'm out of the strange little world that I was in for so long, is the freedom to really think about what I have to do and what I have to be. And that's a very complicated process, needless to say. It's very easy to put it off. I've put it off for 25 years by never not working. Once Ultron was done, I said, okay, let's find out what else is there. And there are a few things which, quite frankly, I can't talk about, which is boring and terrible in a panel, and I apologize for that. But I am sort of exploring new ideas and new formats. I did kind of want to get back to something I love very much, which is putting my hand to a comic book once more. And so beyond everything else, I want to thank the guys at Dark Horse for this. Scott, can you give me an image? This is a book that I will put out next year. It's 6 issues. It basically deals with the most important moral question facing us, which is, why isn't there a Victorian female Batman? So. Beyond that, as I said, stuff I can't talk about. So I'm going to start taking questions fairly soon, if anybody has any. I don't have wisdom necessarily, but I do have something that I would want to say. I was talking to someone yesterday, and we were just talking about ourselves and how we work on ourselves and our work, and a phrase came into my head that was really important to me, and it was simply this: continue to earn what you already have. That for me is like a motto. It has to do with not just gratitude, but active gratitude. That has to do with, I'm standing here in front of all of you people. I'm a writer. I have no business being here and pretending that I'm a rock star. I'm not going to stop anytime soon if I can. But the fact is, this is extraordinary. I know it's extraordinary. But I don't think that's enough. I think what's important to me now that I'm very old is that I continue to give you guys what you are giving me right now, as much as I can in new ways, and not just sort of fall back on, well, I did this one time, you're welcome, here's my next idea, Muffy the zombie fighter, you know. I went into, you know, a very strange, as I said, world, very exciting. I got to make the most personal and surreal blockbuster that I've seen in a long time, and I'm very grateful to Marvel that I got to do that. But this thing of, and you know, what's exciting is that everybody's so perfectly pleased with how I handled Natasha, and you're welcome. Yeah, I still got it. So what I want to say about this, about you coming here to see the X-Men and pretend you're here to see me, is that it's okay. I do too. Thank you. You make me remember how hard I need to work on what it is I'm doing so that I can surprise you and give you not just entertainments, but like a piece of me. That to have that energy from you guys is basically, I'm not sure how else to put it, Comic-Con, the cure for Twitter. So now that I've been all super grateful, I should shut up a little bit. I want to hear some questions. Do we have like mics and people lining up and all that good stuff? I see people raising their hands to show you where to go. And so it begins. Lightning round.
Hi, okay, I know, I gotta hurry. I've been waiting for a long time. I gotta say one thing first. I never had a chance to thank Gene Roddenberry for Aurora. I have to thank you for so silly. Still going to be out there, and not only were we going to be out there, we're going to be strong and beautiful and like best woman out there. And thank you, really, thank you for that. For her. Now, my question: you have a way with balancing that strength and beauty and vulnerability in your female characters that is just unparalleled. No other director, male or female, seems to get that right, but you can be tough and vulnerable. How? How do you do that? How much of that is just sitting down and talking with your actresses and so anyway, that's my question, and thank you again.
Thank you. I myself am tough yet vulnerable, and so I have to draw a lot on that. Honestly, I don't. It's hard for me. I know there are other people out there who do what I do in various mediums extraordinarily well. I love to pretend that I invented feminism or that I'm the most textured writer around. It's simply not the case. I am grateful that something I needed to see more of in popular culture was not only embraced, but is now much more widespread. If we're gonna talk about Zoe? Gina, you get Gina. You hire Gina Torres, and then your life is much easier. Except that you're a little intimidated because she's taller than you. You asked if I spend time talking to the actresses, and it's not really about their experience so much. It's about listening to their voices. It's about hearing how they are best at conveying the thing that we both agree we want to convey, and that's one of the biggest things for me. Is when I have an actor, I need to draw. I can't just sort of plug them in and say, "Now be that person." I've got to draw from them. She has a life force that is bonkers. And we actually know you can't smile too much because the camera would be blinded. But like, we make her adjust, but it's got to be her. It's got to come from her. If they don't feel that creative sort of space, then the characters will just start to become my agenda. There'll be like a polemic of what a strong person should be, and that's not the point. The point is always that it's more complicated than we understand to be any of, to be either weak or strong.
Hello, Josh. My name is Yasone, and I'm a huge fan. I've been a huge fan since I saw Buffy the Vampire Slayer for the first time. Woo! It's my favorite show ever. And I really love everything that you've done, like even all of the Marvel movies, but I especially like the shows that you created, that you invented. You do such wonderful characters that you just fall in love with them and want to see what happens to them. You know, when the show ends, you follow them in the comics. And one of the questions that I've always wanted to ask is, what is the favorite character that you have created?
Favorite ever. My answer would change daily. By the way, that was very, very lovely. You failed to cry. So, like a B plus on this. But I'm still very, fine. Again, my answer could never stop changing. But I kind of feel, how can I not say Buffy? She is the very distilled essence of everything that I am not and want desperately to be or be around. And, she's sort of the nexus, the beating heart of everything I have done or will. So she gets the nod.
Hi, Mom. Hey, how's it going?
I am not your mom, okay? We did the tests. This is getting old.
I'm sorry. No, but, sorry about that. Anyways, love your work. Longtime fan, first time caller. But, so in a perfect world where we have Firefly back on air, because that would be the perfect world, how would you expand on the team? Or would you just continue on with a new team, expand the world that is in Serenity Firefly?
We do not live in a perfect world. I know this because I do not have a flying car. And also my nose. But in a world in which Firefly came back, I think the problem was I didn't have enough interesting characters, so I'd need more. No, wait. That group and what they go through, either together or apart, is something that will fascinate me forever. And I would say you put those 9 people back on that ship, I don't even need anybody else. They can just be on the ship. And I would be writing that forever. And I'm not your mom. But I am your father.
Hi, I'm one of your biggest fans, and I'm sure everyone in this room will say that. But one of my questions is do you have any future plans or any future news that you can tell us about Dr. Horrible 2?
You guys, at some point you're gonna chase me with like pitchforks and torches if I answer this the same way, which I'm about to, which is simply that everybody wants to do it. Everybody's insanely busy. Jed and Marissa are, weekly, daily, hourly, every second, running S.H.I.E.L.D. and being awesome. They also have a child on the side, his little hobby. Zach is up in Canada directing his first movie, which is very exciting. And Neil is doing everything ever, forever, and then hosting a show about the thing he did. So, but I saw him after he did Hedwig, and it was the first thing out of his mouth. Like, when are we doing it? So, we're all looking for that space. I'm unemployed, just saying. But nobody else is. So, again, pending. Sorry, lame. Lame.
Hi, Joss. I'm Jed from Singapore. I just wanted to say how much I admire the amount of personality and character in something like Avengers Age of Ultron, a really big blockbuster that could have easily been really cookie cutter, but has so much to it. I really love that. So my question is, in Cabin in the Woods, the force field has a honeycomb pattern. It's made out of a honeycomb pattern. And the interrogation room in the bus in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. has a honeycomb pattern on the walls. Is that a coincidence at all? Thank you very much.
This is very very simple, and I think everybody can relate to where I am with this. I love bees. I just want to put bees in my clothes and have bee time. Maybe not everyone, like some of you, a few of you. Anyway, it's just a thing. Love bees. No, that's really all I have to say about bees. You can ask.
Hi, Josh. I'm a student filmmaker, and your work has had a huge influence on me, on my own work. And whenever I'm feeling down, I just pop in Once More with Feeling, and everything Woo! Seems right again. So thank you for that. My question is, do you ever censor your character's actions or dialogues for your audience?
Did you say censor?
Yeah. Or moderate.
Yes. Yes. Partially because, you know, a network or a studio or a rating or something. You know, right now I'm writing without any of those things and it's kind of delightful. You know, going in with a format, what you can get away with, what you can't. Pretty much every TV show and even movies, while you're making them and writing them, all of you are also making it in your heads the Simpsons or the porn version, like the most, like the stuff you can never get away with is like fills up half your time. But at the end of the day, yes, you have to, you know, try not to censor yourself in the sense of letting an idea go to waste. But every now and then, you just have to say Mule and Quim and just sort of see if it slides.
So I was asked not to tell how amazing you are. You.
You. Me.
So one of the things I really love that you've done is be able to take characters that we love and turn them dark and then, you know, oh, here's your knife back, you know. So I'm going to use, like, Dark Willow as my example.
Yeah.
When can we see something new like that?
Like just someone going dark, or like I myself am going dark. I'm sort of, but it's hard to tell because I'm so pasty. But it's a dark paste. I'm not sure what you mean in terms of.
Like a character that we know and love, you know what I mean?
Right.
You create that world and then twist it, you know, kind of like maybe like Epitaph One in Dollhouse,
right.
You know.
We'll always be trying to like slide some of that in, but we're not going to tell you who's going to turn dark because that would be giving it away. Dark Willow has a little bit in common with the heroine from Twist. She will be, a slightly edgier character in that sense, but as for which beloved person that I haven't killed yet is actually going to become evil until they can cry and be redeemed, I can't say.
Hello, Joss. Thank you, of course. Blah, blah, blah. My question...
This is getting real boilerplate, okay? Where's my praise?
Well...
Please.
You tell me if this is praise. So, I, like many of us, gain a lot of peace from your work, even though it's peaceful. People who exist in very non-peaceful situations. My question is, what is the world? What is existence? Why are we here? How can I and all of us feel more sane and purposeful in our own lives? And how do you represent that philosophy in your writings?
You think I'm not going to? I'm going to answer that. The world is a random and meaningless, terrifying place, and we all, spoiler alert, die. We are designed to, most critters are just designed not to know that. We are designed uniquely to transcend that, to understand that, oh, I can quote myself, this is fun. A thing isn't beautiful because it lasts. That what we have right now, right here, has as much meaning as anything we're afraid of. And the way we're designed to do this is that the main function of the human brain, the primary instant function, is storytelling. Memory is storytelling. If we all remembered everything, we would be Rain Man and we would not be socially active at all. We learn to forget, and we learn to also distort, and from the very beginning, we're learning to tell a story about ourselves. I keep hoping to be the hero of my story. I'm kind of like the annoying sidekick. I'm like Rosie O'Donnell in the Tarzan movie, you know, the Disney did. I'm like that annoying. I was like, but Tarzan, right? They're like, no, you're that weird ape that we don't know if it's a girl. So. It is still a narrative, and that is, since we're doing that from the moment we're alive, the idea that stories that we then hear and see and internalize and wear hats from and come to conventions about, we all come here to celebrate only exactly that, storytelling, and the shared experience of what that gives us. And it may give us strength, it may just distract us. It may, it can do almost anything. And that for me is how we live peacefully and how we live with ourselves and with each other, is we understand our story, everybody else's story, that we're all part of that, and that story is going to be with us and can be controlled by us and can be surprising and delightful and horrifying, all those things, but it's something we can survive because, unlike me, y'all are the hero of the story. That is my answer.
Hola, señor Whedon. My name is Miguel. I'm from Monterrey, Mexico, just wanted to tell you, you're one of the reasons I'm a working screenwriter right now. My dreams are coming true. And the question is, we all enjoy and love the diversity you put into your characters. When are we seeing more Hispanic characters, Latino? Woo! Preferably Mexicans, but Latinos in general are a plus.
I'm not actually making anything right now on TV or movies, so I can't be the boss of that. But so can I say soon? I've been knocked a couple of times for my track record in terms of race. And when people have come at me and said, you're not really paying attention to diversity enough in your stories and your casting and what you've done in the past, my answer is, yeah, good call. Focus has always been gender. That's always been the thing, and that's like half the people on the planet, so there's a lot of work there. And but I do think, yes, the landscape of this country and this world and the stories we need to tell is more diverse than what I have focused on. So again, my answer is soon.
I'm dressed like this talking to you right now.
I think everybody feels that way.
Say us something!
Lauren, for me, was always very kind of a really deep character who didn't get a lot of notice in the Buffy and Angel verse. I'm very glad when I do this costume to hear great stories that people have about Andy Hallett and when they met him before he passed away. And I was just kind of wondering what was like one of your favorite memories of him. I'm sorry.
No, don't be. Andy was an extraordinary person, and I mean extraordinary like, what the fuck? The first time I met him, really, he was a friend of my wife's sister, and who'd come from Cape Cod, and we went out to, it was like a karaoke place, but kind of fancier, and he went full Patti LaBelle, including a part where she kicks off her shoes and he kicked off his loafers, and he did the whole thing. And I saw him, and it's one of the few times in my life I've ever gone, oh, I need that character. And because he was so bigger than life and completely bonkers. And it was right after season one of Angel, and they'd have the oracles, and you know, we gotta consult the oracles because you gotta have somebody to tell you what's going on. And I thought, oh, we need something that's more LA. And I love the idea that, you know, the karaoke is actually a window into the soul, because you hear someone sing and you understand them in a way that they couldn't express otherwise. That's actually true. So to have him be able to read your future and such when you were singing made perfect sense. And Andy caused that in my head when I saw him, because I was just so blown away. I was like, yes, this LA is much stranger than my show about LA with demons in it. But we did not just hand it to him. He then went through the whole process, and you know, as a dark horse, because he had really never performed, unanimously won the part, and then just kept killing it. Like, he was a force of nature. He's much missed. I'm glad that you are honoring him. Thank you.
Hi, Jonas. Okay, like everybody here, I'm a huge fan. I came all the way here from Moscow. My friends and I love you a lot. And we were here last year, but sorry about your leg. But yeah, I had a question. If you met the younger version of yourself when you started shooting Buffy, what kind of advice would you give to yourself?
Rogaine. You know, I just would have explained discipline to myself a little bit. We had a tendency to be up all night figuring things out, and I think I probably like destroyed crew members with how like sort of my lack of understanding of the nuts and bolts of just getting it done. Honestly, there's not much else I would change. I'm not big on regret. It's not super useful. It's nice to learn lessons, but Buffy was something that I couldn't just explain it to myself. You know, I had to figure it out while I was making it. I had to live it. So I would probably really just concentrate on hair care products. That would be it. And then, you know, some stock tips. And because, you know, I mean, you watch the first season of Buffy, and it's like watching a kid grow up. It's like, oh, they're onto something. Wait, here it comes. And boom, second season, Angel goes bad. You're like, oh, that's what this is. But I wouldn't want to spoil it for myself. Apparently, we have time for one more question.
G'day, Joss.
This has to be the best.
I can do this.
Question.
I'm ready.
Ever.
I really need some advice, and I didn't know who to go to, so I thought I'll just go to Joss Whedon. Feels like the smart move.
Marry the girl. It's the only decent thing to do.
So I've been working really hard in Australia for the last couple of years, and I finally finished my very first feature film, and it comes out in October worldwide, and I am super scared and filled with anxiety 24/7 now. So after your first big project, what was the best decision you made, and what was the one thing you would tell me not to do?
Well, I certainly wouldn't sweat it as much as you are, because you made it. That's your job. Everything else is somebody else's. So whether or not it, you know, hits and, you know, that's not something you can control. And worrying about things you can't control is boring and time consuming. I'm afraid of earthquakes, but I eventually learned to stop thinking about them. See, forgetting, memory. Trying to think the best thing for me was to start something else already, to already be in something else, so that when whatever happens with that project happens, I feel like I have enough energy in this other place that I can withstand the vagaries of fate. And whenever I had any job, I was thinking about, I was working very hard on it, but I was also thinking about the other thing, the next thing that I would want to be doing. It's also very hard after you've made a movie to get back into that. Once people see it, you know, it's a very sort of, it's almost a debilitating thing. James Gunn and I, years ago, ran into each other after we'd made our first movies, and we were like, I can't write. He's like, I can't write. I mean, we can write, but and both of us realized, oh, directing a movie had taken that away from us because we were so, like, debilitated by the idea that the person who cut all the stuff that we wrote that was so good was us. And so we felt like, oh, everything's negotiable, and it was a little paralyzing. And for me, you know, the answer is always, I'm a workaholic, so, you know, it's, my answer to you is gonna be this or beer. I think, you know, a combination of both work and beer, sometimes work during beer, those are the things to reach to. Just remember that this is the first thing, and start thinking about the next. That is the end, except for one thing. You do this now.
All right, Joss, before you go, there's a little something we want to do. We want to have a special presentation for you. And at this time, it is my honor to bring to the stage our director of marketing and PR and my friend, Mr. David Glanzer.
Thank you, Eddie. I'm here to make an announcement, but before I do, there's a little quick story I'd like to tell. What drew me to my very first Comic-Con back in 1978 was movies. I heard there was this thing called the dealer's room, and in the dealer's room you could buy movie posters, you could buy scripts, movie memorabilia, and at the convention had a film room. And back in the day it was 24 hours, and they showed classic films, silent films, films, current films. And that was something that totally intrigued me. When I came in, I found my tribe. It was like the most amazing thing. But I learned there was a lot more to Comic-Con. More than just movies, there were comic books, comic creators, artists, publishers. And well, Comic-Con was this huge umbrella for so many cool things, and it was here that I not only learned about comics, but learned to love them. I relate this story to you guys because I'm here to talk about Joss Whedon. We all know, absolutely, come on. We all know Joss is an amazing screenwriter, director, and producer of film and television, and he is also an amazing creator of comics. Joss quite literally embodies what I discovered so long ago and reiterate every chance I get about Comic-Con. You don't have to love just one area of popular art. You can love it all, and clearly Joss does. From Buffy the Vampire Slayer to Avengers, from Dr. Horrible's sing-along blog to Dollhouse, he's an amazing gift to fandom. And did I forget to mention my favorite, Firefly? How awesome is that? Joss has no fear of creating exciting characters, of creating strong female characters, of creating heroic characters. And Joss also has no fear of killing some of them off. Joss Whedon is a fan's fan. Someone who loves what he does and puts it on paper and screen, big or small, for all of us to enjoy. His talent speaks for itself, and it's a testament to his genius that fans continue to not only flock to his current projects, but revel in the uniqueness and excellence of his past projects. Each year, Comic-Con International presents the Icon Award, which recognizes a person who has been instrumental in creating awareness of and appreciation for comics and related popular art forms and bringing them to wider recognition. Past recipients have included Frank Miller, Neil Gaiman, George Lucas, Stan Lee, Ray Bradbury, June Foray, and Matt Groening. It is my distinct honor on behalf of the Comic-Con Board of Directors, committee, staff, and volunteers to add the name of Joss Whedon to that list.
And to somebody say how great I am, which was like a nightmare. This is honestly the most beautiful murder weapon that I could have gotten. And the fact that they so beautifully scratched out JJ and wrote my name over it, they're so thoughtful. Now I am a Comic-Con icon. Comic-Con. And, you know, being a karma chameleon it's actually, I didn't expect to get moved by it, but I am. I'm really grateful. Thank you. I have worked really hard to give you guys something that would mean something to you, and this means an enormous amount to me. And that's all I'm going to say. God bless. Thanks.
Once again, ladies and gentlemen, let's hear it for our special guest, Dark Horse and Afternoon, with Mr. Joss Whedon.